Hello and welcome at this first session of Getting Technical. The subject of today is a very interesting one. It's about machining titanium and superalloys, and you know, they are very often labeled as very difficult to machine, which is not fair towards these materials, because of course they are not steel. They are different from steel, but if you understand the materials and if you know the properties that influence the machining process, we can see that it's not really so difficult to machine titanium and superalloys. And I already talked a bit mentioned a bit about machining and machinability and that type of thing. Let me start with trying to define with you what exactly is machinability, because especially when we talk about materials, very often people say, yeah, the machinability of titanium, the machinability of aluminium, the machinability of cast iron, but there is more to it than just that. Machinability, the basic concept is about, if you look to a machining process, which is basically a cutting tool, which is removing material from a workpiece by a machining process. And if you look into such a process, there are lots of things happening while you do that. Machinability is a way of describing how that process takes place. And if it's a balanced process, if things are working in a correct way, it's basically kind of, if you look to a cutting tool, there are loads acting on a tool. And the tool itself has an ability to carry loads. And those two must be in balance. And that is exactly what we try to describe with the machinability concept. To which extent is or are things in balance? And if not, and then it's becoming really interesting, if not, why is that and what can we do on it? Now, if we look to loads acting on a tool, loads are coming from all kinds of things. It comes from the process itself and the process conditions. Things, is it a turning application? Is it a milling application? What type of machine tool are you using? Is there a risk for instabilities, vibration, and all that type of things? Loads are coming from the cutting conditions you use, the cutting speeds and the feeds and the depths of cut. Loads are coming from the tool concept you use. And that's for some people a bit difficult to understand perhaps. But if you have a very stable, a strong tool, that is one possibility. You can also have a not so stable, a slender tool, a small tool, and small tool, the not so stable tool, you have to be more careful with. And that's what we try to express here by saying that the tool concept itself is creating a situation where the loads acting on a tool should be seen in a different way. Loads are coming from the workpiece materials. Some materials are more difficult to machine than other materials. And loads are coming from environmental impact. Again, this is one that deserves perhaps a little bit extra explication or explaining. Environmental impact, basically what we talk about here is if we put extra constraints to a machining process, perhaps the easiest to understand is it could be for environmental reasons that we say we want to do dry machining. We don't want to use cooling because cooling is not so nice for the environment and so on. Now, that decision, we want to do dry machining, is going to put extra loads on a cutting tool. And that's what we mean here with environmental impact. So loads are coming to a tool from different corners. On the other hand, you have the tool, and the tool has a certain load-bearing capacity, can withstand the loads, can take the loads. And the building blocks we as tool constructors, as tool producers, the things we work with are the cutting materials, the coatings, the geometries of the tool, the macro geometries. You refer most of the time with ship breaking geometries. It could be the micro geometries, how the cutting edges look. And also, to which extent is the tool fit for purpose? Now, fit for purpose also deserves perhaps some extra explanation here. Fit for purpose means that the tool is used in an application for which the tool is designed for. Some tools are designed for productivity. That means these are the tools that we want to use in such a way that the output of the process is maximized, productive. Other tools are more conceived for cost efficiency. And that means that now in such a case, we have a tool where we use it in such a way that the costs related to process are minimized. Now, if you have a tool designed for cost efficiency and you use it in an application where you want to go for productivity, yeah, you have an issue. So that is something we have to bear in mind. It's not only physical stuff, which carbide grade and which geometry, it's also the idea behind the tool. And that is to express with fit for purpose. Now, loads are acting on a tool, loads are coming from different directions. On the other hand, you have a tool with certain features, so the tool is able to withstand some loads. We want to have a balance. Having that balance means that there are, and I try to illustrate that with the videos also, in the cutting process, there are different types of phenomena taking place. This mechanical stuff going on, because a cutting tool is going to deform material, so much it shears up on the form of a ship. That is the definition of machining. And yeah, you have to push the tool to do that. So there's mechanical things going on. There are tribological things. The tool is in contact with workpiece material. There is pressure, there is movement, and that leads to tribological effects on the tool, wear effect on the tool. There are thermal effects. If you deform material, heat is generated. And when heat is generated, it can lead to higher temperatures. And if the temperature of a tool or a workpiece changes, the properties change. So we have to bear in mind there are chemical loads, because we put together different materials in an environment with higher pressures and temperatures. There is potential chemical reactions that are going to take place. And also here, there are environmental factors that we need to take into consideration. Here it's more environmental. You should understand here as let me say resource efficient. And what do I mean with resource efficient? It is to machining you need energy, and energy that is consumed in the process should be used or should go for minimum energy, for instance. And that is the environmental load, because if we want to have minimum energy consumption, that means that how we use the tool is going to be different. So machinability is about a machining process, a cutting tool. The tool is in contact with workpiece material. We have to find a balance between loads acting on a tool, the load bearing capacity of the tool. And to be able to do that, we have to look at different phenomena, mechanical, tribological, and so on. And to know if we manage to do this, there is a very straightforward method, a very simple method. And the saying goes that if you look to a used tool and you know what to look for, the tool will tell you if there was balance during the process or not. In SECO, we developed a more systematic approach to this concept. We refer to it as a GTDA. A GDA, it's a letter word, sorry for that. It stands for Global Tool Deterioration Analysis. In a systematic way, analyzing used tools learns us a lot, and we are going to use this principle when we talk about titanium and so on, learns us a lot about, did we manage to have the machinability correct in the application we have at hand. Today it's about workpiece materials in this big picture. Today it's more important about titanium workpiece materials and superalloys. Now, if we look to these materials, if we look to whatever workpiece material we machine, normally people refer back to the ISO system. And I suppose you are all familiar with the ISO system. We refer to PMK and SH material groups. And then we say, okay, we if we have an application, we have to see the material, we have to machine in which group it belongs, and then we can find advice for which tool to use and so on. But what we sometimes forget in this system, this ISO system, and it goes back to the mid-70s of the last century, this ISO system, and in those days, basically the only material, the most machined materials were steel and cast irons. And if you machine steel and cast iron, it's mainly the mechanical properties that you have to keep your eyes on. If you want to know how the machining process will go, you know, all the things we just talked about, the mechanical effects and the thermal effects and so on. So the ISO system, and the beauty is it's simple, is based on mechanical properties. But I already could give you here an example. The example is if you look to titanium, for instance, titanium, if you compare it with the traditional steel, is basically softer. And if you look to used tools in titanium, you'll see that they show quite a lot of shipping on the cutting edge. And normally when we discuss about wear, shipping is an indication that the cutting forces are too high. And here we have at first sight something which is very strange, a softer material normally which gives lower cutting forces. Yet, if I look to the cutting edges, they tell me the cutting forces were high. So mechanical properties is not really helping us, because if you look to materials, and especially the modern materials, titanium and so on, there's next to pure mechanical things, there is the microstructure of the material, there are the alloying elements, thermal treatments and so on, or with other words, to have a full picture of a material from a machining perspective, there is more than mechanical properties. It's about alloying elements, thermal properties, strain hardening effects, the structure of the material, inclusions, impurities, all of that plays a role. And today we concentrate on the so-called S group, according to ISO, the superalloys, mainly the nickel-based alloys and the titanium alloys. And if we look to those materials, there is a danger that you end up in the hands of metallurgists. Now, be very careful, because if I look to materials, I look to materials within the back of my head, machining, machinability, and all the metallurgical things is for me not so important. If I look to machining as a process, the only thing I'm after is what properties and how the properties are built in the material. Yeah, that's for the metallurgists. I only worry about the properties that will influence the machining process, that will influence the machinability. And if we investigate in this, if we do research in this, we find out that next to mechanical properties, the ones you see here in the picture to the right, hardness, ductility, and abrasiveness. There are two others which are extremely important when we machine superalloys and titanium alloys. And the labeling, these are difficult materials, dates back from when we did not take into account thermal conductivity and strain hardening. We didn't think on that. And it were exactly those two who created the main issues. It's about five properties. Now, to work with five properties, what you see here is a visualization of five properties in a diagram with five axes, so-called polar diagram. So we talk about adhesiveness, ductility, which from a machining perspective is kind of the same thing, abrasiveness and hardness, the three traditional mechanical properties. So the left side of this diagram, we refer more or less to as the mechanical side. If you look to the right side, you see strain hardening and thermal conductivity, which are the two properties we did not really take into account in the past. And a diagram like you see here, you see a scale from 0 to 10. 0 means the property is to such an extent present in the material that it does not affect machinability in a negative sense. So strangely enough, in this diagram, 0 means don't worry, no problem. 10 means big problem, be careful. So the closer a property reaches the 10 level, the more careful you have to be when you do machining, the more you will have to be aware of that a certain property will lead to certain phenomena that could be dangerous for the cutting tool, and you as a machinist, you will have to compensate for that. That's how this system, it's developed by Professor Stahl in Sweden, together with a whole group of companies. Seco was one of the companies when he was developing this system. And if you apply this system, and what you see here are visualizations, and this system works by comparison. You see here the reference material we take to compare is 42 chromium molybdenum 4. Which is a traditional steel we know rather well, and we know rather well what a good cutting tool is, and we know rather well how to do the machining, which cutting conditions to use, and so on. So my 42 chromium molybdenum 4 is my reference material. And then if I take to the left a very typical and even standardized superalloy, alloy 718, most probably know it under the commercial name Inconel 718, which is kind of a reference material for superalloys. To the right, you see a typical titanium alloy. And if you look for the two materials then to the five properties we just talked about, and I start on the top and I move clockwise, it's adhesion. Strain hardening is the second, low thermal conductivity is the third one, hardness and abrasiveness. We talk about five because adhesion ductility will be an indicator for if you have high adhesion, high ductility, you will have long ships, you will have problems with build-up edges during machining. That's the thing we have to worry about. Strain hardening means that you have hard scales, hard surfaces in which you will have to cut. Low thermal conductivity means that the heat which is generated during machining is not fully evacuated with the ships, stays in the cutting zone, leads to higher temperatures in the cutting zone, and we will have to take care of that. Hardness means high cutting forces, high mechanical loads. We need strong tools to take care of that. And abrasiveness is kind of a scratching effect. The material is going to do an abrasive attack on cutting edges That means we need cutting edges that can withstand that. Now, if you look to the two materials, and if you concentrate for just a second to the left side, the mechanical side, I called it, adhesion, abrasiveness, hardness, you see that both alloy 718 and the titanium alloy are less demanding than steel, really. So that is not the tricky part. The tricky part is the right side. We see that strain hardening effects, especially in the alloy 718, are a lot higher than in traditional steel. And we see that low thermal conductivity, especially when we look at the titanium material, are on a much more severe level present than in traditional steel. So, and here it started years ago. Titanium Connell, difficult to machine. What did the traditional machinist do? He thought, ooh, my colleague said difficult. I'm going to use a strong tool, just in case. And by doing so, he did exactly the opposite of what he should have been doing, because if you look to these materials, strain hardening and low thermal conductivity, we have to compensate those by keeping the temperatures low during machining. And how do we keep temperatures low during machining? We do that by using sharp tools. So it was a full misunderstanding from the beginning. We used strong tools to handle a problem which basically should have been handled by using sharp tooling. And yeah, of course, if you start from the beginning with a completely wrong tool you selected, yeah, you end up in problems, obviously. Yeah. I have to keep my eyes on the time, because yeah, these materials always excites me a little bit. Here you see one slide an overview of basically everything which is behind this system and everything we need to know from a practical perspective. The top line, if you have a certain material and one of the five properties we mentioned here is to a higher level than the traditional what we know about present, that during machining will cause certain phenomena. That's the second line. I skip the line in the middle. I go directly to the bottom where it says general recommendations for tool selection and cutting condition selection. What you find there is if a material property is predominantly present. So you have to be careful with it because it will cause certain phenomena during machining that can be problematic. Your tool selection must be influenced by that. You have to balance it again. Cutting material selection and geometry selection, and how you use the tool, cutting condition selection. The line in the middle leads to a certain tool wear aspect that I'm going to use directly, because that's going to be my closing stone. The materials we talk about, titanium alloys, super alloys, it's about high adhesion and ductility we have to worry about. It's about high strain hardening factors. It's about low thermal conductivity. These are the three we have to worry about. And if I look to tool wear, the tool wear we should see when we machine these materials is I hope it's visible on the screen for you. It's very typical tool wear, plastic deformation, shipping. You see the shipping? Is popping up. That you have shipping in titanium machining is quite normal. Don't worry. It's about the high, it's due to the high strain hardening combined with the low thermal conductivity. So it's rather normal. When we were testing this system, and here the keyword on top is chaos with a question mark, chaos in machining. Trust me, we don't like chaos in machining. But anyway, when we were testing this system, it was in Alloy 718. So we did our tool selection, cutting condition selection. We ended up with all the tools broke. So we thought, there goes the system, it doesn't work. But closer investigation learned us when we tested the different materials, the different work pieces we were machining, that as a matter of fact, the material, the properties of the materials were not in line with expectations. What you see here to the right is the reality. Left is what we thought it was going to be. So we thought it was going to be Alloy 718. We selected sharp cutting tools, which is what we need, see the previous slide. But as you can see, we found materials with abrasiveness factors, which were extremely high. Now, if you use a sharp tool in a material with high abrasiveness factors, of course you break the tool. And that is very often what I refer to as chaos in machining. And other examples of chaos, burr formation in this type of material. And people say, why are there so many burrs when I machine this type of? Because you have high ductility. That's why you have so many burrs. So we can tackle this problem. Why do we have so much long ships when we machine these materials? Yeah, the high ductility again. Black spots, perhaps the biggest problem of all when people do machine titanium, the famous black spots. Why do we have black spots? Very strangely, also the high ductility, build up edges that tear out and so on. And chaos is something we should not want to have, because chaos is frustrated operators, frustrated engineers, and it's frustrated customers, because work pieces which are delivered are not in line with expectations, and that's not so nice. To come to a conclusion, Inconel materials, super alloys, titanium alloys, they are different from steel. Steel in our world still today is the reference, is the material we know. We are familiar with it. We know the tooling, we know the cutting conditions, and then suddenly you are confronted with these new materials. Well, the difference is not on the mechanical side. See the visuals here? It's on the thermal side. That's what we have to worry about or to think on. Material challenges, titanium and superalloys do not soften while being machined. That's different from steel. This leads to high loads during machining. So that more cutting edges break, it doesn't make us happy, but okay, it's part of the game. You have, especially in titanium, a low modulus of elasticity, big burr formation, problems with dimensional tolerances, especially when you have thin walls, they bend easily. And the pre-machining things which have been on the workpieces, forging, precipitation hardening, be careful with those, because they can be very sneaky later on when the material needs to be machined. This is what you have to be aware of when it comes to materials. From a machining perspective, you have high strengths and at elevated temperatures. That means, relatively seen, you will have rather high cutting forces when you machine these materials. High toughness and ductility, poor ship formation, build-up edges, side flow problems, black spots is the worrying thing. Low thermal conductivity, remind, think on it. The heat is not as much as in steel machining, evacuated in zone. It will lead to higher temperatures. Strain hardening effects. It causes extra notch wear, gives harder ships. It's something you have to be aware of. General machining guidelines. Use strong tools, positive cutting geometries, sharp cutting edges. Always good advice. People will say, yeah, but how can you, yeah, I see quite a lot of breakage, which is normal, and yet, yeah, it's a balance we have to find here. Use big depths of cut, medium feeds, medium to high feeds, maximize the volume of ships to take the heat out of the process as much as possible. Use cutting speed as a balancing factor, because you have to have your cutting temperatures at the correct level. I would say basic choice is big depths of cut, medium feeds, rather low cutting speeds. If for some reason you keep the depths of cut low and the feeds low, I think on finishing, I think on treading, that type of applications, you should increase the cutting speeds to increase the temperatures. Cooling is important, because everything that helps us to evacuate the heat out of the cutting zone is important. If possible, you use high pressure directed cooling systems, what in SECO we call jet stream cooling, is a very interesting thing. And do change your cutting edges on a regular basis, not too much wear. Change them in due time. And that brings me to the GTDA. This methodology helps you a lot, especially in these type of materials. You know now this diagram. Well, this diagram, every property comes with a certain typical wear. If you evaluate the reality according to a kind of a standardized approach, out of what you measure in your reality, advice for what to do and which tools and how to use the tools can be derived and be custom made. Which brings me to a conclusion. It's very short. I hope in this short time I came with a story that makes sense. Machining titanium, machining Inconel type materials, cobalt alloy type materials is a challenge. It's not as easy as steel, but they do not deserve either to be labeled constantly as very difficult. They are not so difficult as a lot of people still think. It's based on a misunderstanding. It's based on not taking into account the strain hardening effects, the low thermal conductivity, the high ductility effect. When using correct tooling in a correct way, you'll see that those materials are machining is honestly not so difficult. It's different, I admit to that. Questions? I see in the meantime a number of questions here. Which type of geometry is suggested for titanium and Inconel? Both are roughly the same. I would say I would go for a positive geometry. Let me specify a positive, so a sharp macro geometry, but a strong micro geometry. The cutting edge itself deserves to be a little bit stronger, but the ship breaking geometry should be positive, should be sharp. The next question is about gravitational force effects. I have to ask the one who asked this question to specify, what do you mean with gravitational force effects? Please in the chat explain a little bit more on gravitational, what you mean with that. The next question is, I use the academic correct term strain hardening. Strain hardening is an effect where a material is getting stronger under influence of deformation. If you put stress in the material, it becomes stronger. That's called strain hardening. But indeed, a lot of people talk about work hardening. It's exactly the same thing. It's just the words are different. Other people sometimes refer to it as surface hardening. It's basically also the same phenomenon. I also see a question. microstructure and grain size plays a role, although be careful. I would say don't worry too much about that. Don't end up in too many metallurgical discussions. Take it very, very, very sec. A grain size is going to influence certain properties. And I'm thinking on mainly, perhaps not in this material, but in stainless steel, for instance, type of structure and grain size is going to decide a lot on which type of metallurgical structure you have. And if you end up with what is referred to as a martensitic structure, a martensitic structure leads to higher cutting forces. So, but I'm always careful with that type of metallurgical discussions. The same, as a matter of fact, goes for composition. Lots of people start discussing X percent of chromium and X percent of titanium and X percent of this and X percent of that. And then they try to connect machinability factors to it. Now, extremely, extremely careful with that. It's not a science. It's more expertise in a sense. You once had it and you learn by experience what happened and you remember that. But on the other hand, if you want to see it from a knowledge perspective, normally if you add titanium to a structure, to a material as an alloying element, it makes machinability more difficult. It creates a lower machinability. Okay. If you add chromium to a material, idem dito, the same thing happens. It influences machinability in a negative effect. So that could lead us to a conclusion: titanium is not good and chromium is not good. Okay. Now we do difficult, we add both. And then something very strange happens. If you add titanium and your machinability goes down, and then you add chromium, the chromium will make, in combination with titanium, make your machinability go up again. If you put only chromium and no titanium, it makes your machinability go down. So be careful with that machinability thing related to composition. Again, it's not a science. I know this thing. I can't explain it. I'm not a metallurgist, but I know I have to be careful with chromium alone. I have to be careful with titanium. And I know if I have the combination, it's going to be worse than only chromium, but less than only titanium. But yeah. The same goes with grain size, structures. It's so be careful with it. There is a physicist in the group. How to estimate the aggressiveness and adhesion parameters with what type of test? There are two approaches. One approach is we learned based on testing and experience that adhesion and the effect of adhesion is directly related to ductility. The higher the ductility of a material, the more adhesive working there will be of a ship towards a cutting tool. And it makes sense, you know, high ductility. What means high ductility? It means a softer material. And if you have a softer material and you put it in contact with a cutting edge, it melts. Melting is a big word. It melts closer into the structure of the cutting tool, leading to higher adhesion. So one rather straightforward thing is, tell me the ductility, and somehow it gives me an idea about adhesive working on towards a cutting edge. On the other hand, there are typical machining tests being developed where we take a tool, we take a set of cutting conditions, we machine for a certain time, we stop, and we measure the build-up edge, which is the consequence of adhesive working of workpiece material on a cutting edge. So there is the simple way. Look at the ductility. High ductility, and what is high? I would say if it's above 30-35%, be very careful. There will be rather high adhesive working. That's the straightforward approach. If that is not satisfying, we need more machining tests to figure it out. Which type of insert should I use to avoid burr formation? When the workpiece is okay, sharp tooling is going to minimize burr formation. What I do now is I give very short answer. There's quite a lot more, but then we have to start diving into what is called burr-free machining, which is a subject on its own. But in general, seeing the time here, I would say use sharp tooling. Effect of tool spindle run out on machinability of these materials, I would say nothing. The spindle run out is not going to influence the machinability of a material in the better or in the worst sense. Workpiece tolerances and stuff, that's another story, of course. What kind of cutting fluid is recommended is the questions continue to come in. A greasy one. I would say if you use emulsion cooling is good. Traditional emulsion cooling, the standard says 4-6% oil, cutting oil in water. That from a machining perspective is best, although I know in a lot of workshops they do lesser for cost saving reasons, but okay, again another discussion. If you machine titanium Inconel based alloys, from a machining perspective I would say go for 10%, 15%. If possible use HPDC cooling type. Jet stream tooling is strongly recommended in this type of material. Basically, that type of cooling is developed for this type of workpiece materials. What would I recommend? Coolant or cryogenic? Cryogenic, of course, obviously, if that is possible. And is it interesting to reuse, regrinded inserts? But I think I understand what you mean. Regrinded tooling, solid carbide tools or whatever, or if you want inserts, okay for me. For rough machining, yes. No worries. But I would strongly recommend if you do the regrinding, also do the reconditioning of the cutting edges. Because that is of vital importance in this type of material. Titanium beta annealed, yeah, more difficult than the alpha. Would it be better to use a small nose radius than a big? Yes. Although 0.2 is in my, I don't know the application you are thinking on, but I would say whatever you are used nose radiuses in steel, if you have to machine titanium super, take one lower. If you do 0.8 for roughing, 0.4 for finishing in steel, do 0.4 for roughing and 0.2 for finishing in titanium alloys. How about machining with ceramics? Difficult question. Some applications it work very well. In other applications, it doesn't work at all. The same for CBN materials. In some applications, it gives very good results. In other applications, the results are not so good. It's depending on quite a lot of factors. Type of operation, milling, turning, time in cut. Do you have long time in cut or do you have short time in cut? type of cooling is having an influence here. So this is a difficult one to give you one single answer. It's strongly depending on the actual application. Can I explain mechanical properties? The mechanical properties we talk about when we talk about machining is the hardness. The hardness of a material. I suppose you are familiar with hardness. Ductility, the extent to which you can deform a material before it breaks, which is measured together with the tensile strength of a material. It's also a standard one. Abrasiveness is a more difficult one. Abrasiveness is measured with a scratching test. But there are standardized testing to measure abrasiveness also. And now my colleague is telling me I have to stop talking. The time is up. Yet I see questions are still coming in, which is nice. A lot more information you find in what we refer to as our technical education programs. In SECO, we refer to them as STEP. STEP is SECO Technical Education Programs. It are focused short-running development programs for machining, and it offers technical education and training for machining professionals, operators, engineers, even managers in the machining industry. All the questions, I seen the time, I could not give an answer. I'll give an answer later on in the chat. I hope in the meantime, I find in the chat also the gravitational forces thing, because I'm still thinking on what do you mean with that? It's intriguing. I hope it was an interesting 45 minutes we had together here. Very short, but I tried to mention at least the most important things. A material very close to these is stainless steel. One could say stainless steel is the better quality steel, if you allow me to say that. Stainless steel also could say is one of the easier superalloys. But it's so important as a material, we decided to spend a special session on that. The second session in Getting Technical is going to be machining of stainless steels, which is a challenge on its own. Thank you very much. It was nice meeting you here and looking forward to see you, to meet you again for the next one, machining of stainless steels. And there we are going to talk about structures, because they are important then. Thank you. Talk to you later. Hope to see you back.